laboratory directions for the male reproductive system, learning objectives for the male reproductive systems. 1. Be able to identify and describe the general histological architecture of the testis. 2. Be able to identify and describe the cell types comprising the germinal epithelium of the seminiferous tubules and the functional significance of each. 3. Be able to identify and describe the interstitial tissue and understand the functional significance of the contained Leydig cells. 4. Be able to identify and describe the histological structure of the different regions constituting the excretory ductal system that links the testis to the urethra, and be able to relate the structural significance of each. And 5. Be able to identify and describe the histological structure of the male accessory sex glands and relate the structure of these glands to their function. This is a region of the testis as seen with the scanning objective. The area as indicated by the pointer is that dense connective tissue covering the testis, known as the tunica albiginea, consisting primarily of collagen, fibroblast, although there is a few scattered occasional smooth muscle cells are present. This happens to be a primate testis because of the better preservation using this particular specimen. And if one focuses on the arrow, this is where the tunica vasculosa would be, that which resides just interior, along the interior surface of the tunica albiginea. If we course along here, you can see it's relatively or at least vessels aren't obvious in this particular preparation at this magnification. Here we have a small arteriole, another one entering at this particular point. Nonetheless, it's not obvious on this particular specimen, but it is quite obvious if one examines human preparations. Now if we go down and begin down on the external surface of the tunica albiginea, one should, even at this magnification, barely perceive some flattened mesothelial cells lying on the external surface of the tunic. This would be the visceral layer of the tunica vaginalis. So we go from tunica vaginalis, that very thin mesothelial lining, tunica albiginea, should be a tunica vasculosa here, and then finally getting into the seminiferous tubules, which of course fill the heart of the testis. So each one of these structures, very closely packed together, is an example of a seminiferous tubule. And the testis consists of a number of such tubules, and fills the entire field of view. Though not obvious on this particular preparation, the interstitial tissue will lie between the seminiferous tubules and separate them. And this is where the Leydig cells, or the interstitial cells, of course, will be found. And these, as you will recall, produce the male sex steroid, testosterone. So find and identify some of the seminiferous tubules and examine them at increased magnification for the various cell types. The same testis, viewed at a slight increase in magnification, to perhaps show in greater detail the seminiferous tubules. One is shown here, another here. These, of course, are being cut in cross-section or transverse section, and another profile here, but begins to meander off and head down towards the bottom of the field. Another of these tubules is cut and more or less along its length, at least for a short distance, and the lumen of the seminiferous tubule courses here as indicated by the arrow or the tip of the arrow, and then curves back around to the right. Another profile would be shown here. So we have several seminiferous tubules packed very closely together in this particular specimen, and the interstitial tissue, at least on this sample, is very, very difficult to discern. However, one will chance upon small areas such as here, and around here one can see small blood vessels. This is where one should look for the interstitial cells, the interstitial tissue, and the Leydig cells that will reside within it. So these are seminiferous tubules, several of them, seen at a little bit higher magnification than the previous example, just to illustrate the boundaries of the tubules perhaps a little bit better, and the intervening interstitial type tissue that lies, of course, between these closely packed seminiferous tubules. So one should just arbitrarily pick one, begin to look at it at increased magnification, and examine several cross-sectional profiles of the seminiferous tubules, as there will be different cell associations with each profile. As one looks at these two, as indicated by the arrow, one can see the mature spermatids, or the late spermatids, I should say, in the apical region, or what would be the apical region, of the Sertoli cell. They're relatively mature and are about to be released by the seminiferous tubule, that is, the Sertoli cells. Compare these two profiles with some of the adjacent ones, and you can see that the cell association is different. There's different stages of spermatogenesis that are taking place, or are frozen in time in this particular these particular tubes. So examine a couple of these and just note the cell types at increased magnification. This field is the cross-section of a seminiferous tubule seen at increased magnification. Perhaps one of the first things that's advisable to do is to see where the position of the Sertoli cells. A Sertoli cell nucleus is shown here. Another one is shown here. Cytoplasm of one is shown here. The nucleus of another is shown here. The nucleus of another Sertoli cell is shown here and has the good, well-defined nucleolus as indicated by the tip of the arrow. A Sertoli cell is shown here, another here with that characteristic nucleolar profile, another here, and another one being crossed by the arrow. If one looks at this particular Sertoli cell, one can visualize the cytoplasmic base, or the boundary where it lies upon a basal lamina next to this paratubular connective tissue that's surrounding the seminiferous tubule. That's what these flattened cells, or those so-called myoid cells, that make up this paratubular or boundary type of connective tissue. So this is an example of some of those cell types. But getting back to the Sertoli cell, its base will lie on the basement membrane. This is the cytoplasm of this particular Sertoli cell. And remember, the Sertoli cell will go reach or extend from the basal lamina all the way to form the lining of the seminiferous tubule. So its cytoplasmic apex is somewhere in this particular region. So this is the boundary of this particular, or the height, I should say, of this particular Sertoli cell. One can somewhat make out the cytoplasmic extent of this one. It goes here and then perhaps up this far. Nonetheless, Those are the Sertoli cells. These dark staining, darkly stippled nuclei along the base belong to the spermatogonia. They're oval-shaped cells that hug and lie on the basement membrane. They would be within the basal compartment of this particular germinal epithelium. This would be spermatogonia, another spermatogonium here. By simple chance, these are all classified as type A spermatogonia. One such is up at the opposite end for comparison and lying on the basement membrane. This would be more akin to a type B spermatogonium. The cell types in meiosis, with the chromosomes as indicated by the pointer, these are all primary spermatocytes. And of course, we have the late spermatids within the lining the lumen of this particular tubule. An additional field to show two adjacent seminiferous tubules that are in different stages of a seminiferous wave. The cell types in the one shown to the right, one can make out the Sertoli cells. Then down at the bottom, I can't quite reach it, the spermatogonia, though not as quite as well preserved, primary spermatocytes. All of these smaller round ones, like this association here, are early spermatids. These appear to be, even at this mag, one can make out they're still in cytoplasmic continuity. And these are the heads of the late spermatids with their tails extending out into the lumen of the seminiferous tubule, about to be released by the Sertoli cell. One can see a little bit better on this particular specimen the base of the Sertoli cell, its cytoplasm extending to the apex and is associated with the five or six late spermatids shown in its apex. A few residual bodies, the cytoplasmic droplets that are being shed can also be seen scattered in the lumen. One can even see evidence of phagocytosis by the Sertoli cells of these particular cast-off bits of cytoplasm. So one can make out quite well in this case the base to the apex of the Sertoli cell gives you its length. It does show the good nuclear profile, and one can envision these cells going up along its lateral surface and then coming back down. That is the spermatogenic cells. This particular tubule looks quite a bit different because different associations are in evidence. It's pushed a little bit, it appears. This is a Sertoli cell here as defined by its nucleus. Another one is shown here. The gonia, of course, would be down at the base as well. These are the primary dividing spermatocytes, and these are all, these small round nucleated cells are all early spermatids. A field of the intervening interstitial tissue between profiles from four seminiferous tubules to illustrate a Leydig cell in this particular preparation. This is the nucleus of the Leydig cell. It, in this case, shows a very distinct nucleolus. Its cytoplasm extends about this far and is being traced by the pointer. So this and this particular preparation is the Leydig cell. Remember, it is the cell type that's producing testosterone, the male hormone, in this particular prep. And it is going to be under the control of interstitial cell secreting hormone, or stimulating hormone, I should say, the equivalent to LH in the female system. two adjacent Leydig cells, as indicated by the pointer, in the interstitial tissue between seminiferous tubules, as seen at high magnification. Please recall that these particular cells are the target of interstitial cell stimulating hormone, or LH, their equivalent terms, and that the primary secretory product of this cell type is testosterone. Another short clip of the seminiferous tubule looking at the germinal epithelium, but extreme magnification, extremely high magnification. This is rather an unusual preparation. That's why I'm illustrating it once again, because you can make out the luminal border made up of the Sertoli cells. It's curving around in this direction. So once again, to repeat at this high magnification, these are the Sertoli cell nuclei. Here's another one indicating the characteristic nucleolus. Another is shown here, and another one is shown here. The cytoplasm extends from where it lies on the basement membrane and is adjacent to this paratubular connective tissue to this location, where one can make out the fused apical cell membranes. The other cell types that can be visualized within this preparation, if I move this just slightly, are spermatogonia, the primary spermatocytes, once again, early spermatids, as indicated by the pointer, and late spermatids. This is sort of flat on, and this is cut at the other angle if you turned a plate vertically towards your face and looked at it. One can even make out the beginning of the middle piece here in the spermatozoa. So they are late spermatid. So these are almost two spermatozoa. One can make out the tails coming off, so they're well formed, and it wouldn't be very long before they were transported up and released by the Sertoli cell. Another spermatogonium, perhaps a little bit better, showing its oval nature of its cytoplasm and its nucleus, is shown in the adjacent seminiferous tubule. Please do recall that the Sertoli cell is the target of FSH coming from gonadotrophs in the anterior pituitary, and that its primary secretory products are androgen binding protein and that glycoprotein known as inhibin. This is a preparation of adult human testis. I think it's important to see at least a portion of these preparations of human material. Arrow indicates at the very edge, once again, the simple squamous mesothelium of the tunica vaginalis. This region here of dense collagen obviously is going to be the tunica albuginea. Now, what this particular preparation shows in a that the primate or the monkey preparation does not show is the well-developed nature of the tunica vasculosa, which lies along the interior surface of the tunica albuginea. Here is a large, well, not a large, but a well-developed artery coursing along this area of the connective tissue. The seminiferous tubules obviously are located to the extreme right of the field, but let's course along this boundary between that intense concentration of the seminiferous tubules and the surrounding or limiting tunica albuginea. Another large vessel, as one can see, as viewed in cross-section, indicating there. These are small arteries much smaller caliber one shown here. So as one courses along the internal surface of the tunicate albuginea, unlike the primate one, one can see the intense vascular supply coursing along this interior surface of the tunica albuginea. Here we see another fairly large vessel that's cut sort of at an oblique angle. Other profiles shown here, and one can then make out feeder vessels going into the interstitial tissue that is going to supply the nutritional needs of this particular organ, or the seminiferous tubules. And here we can see, again, most of the profiles we're visualizing are small arteries. The veins are perhaps collapsed somewhat or empty, but one gets much better idea. The connective tissue is a little bit looser, and it is containing these very, very large vessels. So that primate preparation, though excellent in its preservation, it's just a little bit misleading because one doesn't get the impression of the intense vascularity that one sees looking at the human preparation. Here you can see a little bit larger or smaller artery, I should say, actually coursing into between the seminiferous tubules. And here we have a small vein. So those are is one difference and one that everyone should be aware of, this tunica vasculosa. It is indeed a prominent structure in the human condition. These are all seminiferous tubules of this human preparation. And you can see there are small arteriole caliber vessels meandering in the interstitial tissue and between the seminiferous tubules. The tunica albuginea, once again, seen at increased magnification, simply to illustrate the visceral layer of the tunica vaginalis, that simple squamous mesothelial covering that lies on the exterior surface of the tunica albuginea. And this is just a run through the tunica albuginea of the human testis. Dense interwoven collagenous connective tissue. A fairly well preserved region of human testis, showing several profiles through the seminiferous tubules. One is large one is shown at the base of the field, or the bottom of the field. One is indicated here, one coursing across the top, and then one to the left. This area here is the intervening interstitial connective tissue, or interstitial tissue, showing an arteriole, another arteriole here. But within this primitive type of connective tissue, one can make out a fairly decent cluster of the Leydig cells, or the interstitial cells, those cells that are producing testosterone. And even at this relatively low magnification, one can make out the crystalloids of Reinke within the cytoplasm of these particular steroid-producing cells. This one here appears to be binucleate, and this too is not an uncommon feature of these particular cells. This field represents a high-power view of Leydig cells. So there's a cluster of Leydig cells in the center of the field of view, and is being traced by the pointer. A seminiferous tubule is shown to the right, one to the left, and one at the top of the field of view. So we're in the interstitial connective tissue, even though it's pulled apart. So each one of these large cells is a human Leydig cell, and this dark staining body, with the eosinophilic nature to it within these cells, are these crystalloids of Reinke. So they're very large, round cells, and in the human condition, unlike that primate that was observed earlier, oftentimes will form into these large clusters of cells in the interstitial tissue. So these are the cells, the testosterone-producing cells, showing you both a relatively abundant cytoplasm. They're fairly large cells, and with these very prominent crystalloids, the crystalloids of Reinke. These are two adjacent seminiferous tubules from that human testis, just to illustrate the germinal epithelium in this particular preparation, though it's much less well preserved. These nuclei, as indicated by the pointer, because of their nucleoli and sort of light nuclear staining, considerable amount of euchromatin, are the nuclei of the Sertoli cells. So they can be made out quite readily, even on a poorly preserved and a relatively thick specimen, as this particular one is. So this is a nuclear profile of a Sertoli cell. This is one, Sertoli cell, Sertoli cell, Sertoli cell there, Sertoli cell, and Sertoli cell. The roundish cells beneath them, spermatogonia, 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 and a couple other spermatogonia. The ones in division, as before, primarily are the primary spermatocytes, so they too can be visualized, as indicated by the pointer, though not as crisply and well preserved as the monkey preparation is, and is the reason for actually using it. These are all primary spermatocytes. The little arrowhead or little dark projections in here are the late spermatids. This is another cluster of the early spermatids. So everything's virtually the same, other than the fact that the cell types aren't nearly as well preserved, obviously. This is the paratubular tissue with the myoid cells in the human condition. If we go down to this bottom field, we can see everything repeats itself again, even though the cell associations are a little bit different. So this would be just for additional examples, Sertoli cell, Sertoli cell, the nuclei of Sertoli cells, I should be saying. Sertoli cell, once again, the characteristic, the euchromatic nucleus and the nucleolus, those are the keys. One showing here, 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 there, there, and they can be made out. These would be spermatogonia, once again, along the base. Even a type A can be discerned here, once you know what the criteria, what to look for because of the nuclear vacuole. Very close observation because it's staining so darkly. All of these cells, as indicated by the arrow dart, are in this meiotic division, with the chromosomes being quite visible, are the primary spermatocyte. Other examples are seen here. And then, of course, the little dark arrowhead type things are the our cells are the late spermatids, and then there's some early spermatids here. So virtually all the cells can be visualized, but they're not nearly as well preserved as seen on this human testis. Even two Leydig cells have made their way into this particular field of view. So these are human seminiferous tubules as seen at high magnification. This is a section through a prepubertal boy, once again showing the tunica albiginea as being crossed by the arrow, developing seminiferous tubules as shown to the extreme right, and then one can even make out the visceral layer of the tunica vaginalis on the exterior surface of the tunicae albiginea. But as one courses into the interior of this developing testis, several profiles of the seminiferous tubules can be discerned quite readily, together with the intervening interstitial tissue, some of which contains vasculature containing red cells. Having once seen this particular view, it should be examined at increased magnification and compared with the adult testis. Seminiferous tubules of the prepubertal testis as seen at increased magnification. Please recall that the germinal epithelium in this particular type of a preparation, that is from a prepubertal boy, consists primarily of Sertoli cells. And this is the nuclear profiles, the vast majority of which are shown here. And though it's not that well preserved, it will be sort of a tall columnar form of epithelium. And scattered between the bases of the Sertoli cells making up this type of seminiferous epithelium, if we can get to a field here, one can make out sort of larger empty appearing cells. These would be the spermatogonia that lie within the bases, sandwiched within this Sertoli lining type of epithelium, and being lying and ready to receive the signals for spermatogenesis at the time of puberty. Here are perhaps a couple of a little bit better profiles through the seminiferous epithelium, showing the Sertoli cells and a spermatogonia showing here. Another one profile of a seminiferous tubule here with the spermatogonia at those two particular locations. So the germinal epithelium consists primarily of a Sertoli type of cell, or the Sertoli cell. It'll look a little bit different once it's stimulated by FSH. This particular point, it looks like a tall columnar type of epithelium, and nestled in between the bases, along the basement membrane of the Sertoli cells, one will find scattered spermatogonia, as indicated by the arrow. So are the seminiferous tubules from the testis of a prepubertal boy. Unfortunately, I was unable to acquire some initial sections through the excurrent duct system, that is through the medial sinal area. So what is going to be missing are the tubuli recti, or the straight tubules of the seminiferous tubules. That is those short interconnecting segments of the seminiferous tubules that lack spermatogenic cells. And then the reedy testis, which lies within the mediastinal area, as well as the efferent ductules. So those three segments will not be shown. The tubular recti, a section through the reedy testis, or the efferent ductules. So the next, or the first of the excurrent ductal system that we have a specimen of is that of the epididymis. This particular field represents a medium power view of the ductus epididymis. Remember, this particular duct is 7 or 8 meters in length, so it's the very same duct or tubule cut in cross-section. It just highly folded upon itself. So all of these profiles are through the the same duct, it's just tightly coiled and you're getting several profiles through it. Typically appearing epididymis, a series of cross-sectional profiles through tubules with intervening connective tissue tightly holding them together. An initial observation, one might think one was dealing with the seminiferous tubules within the testis. However, note that there are no spermatogenic cells present, which makes that initial observation easily dispelled. The epididymis, or the ductus epididymis, will consist of a lining epithelium that consists of two cell types, a principal cell, which will show the stereocilia from its apical surface. This is the most prominent and the tallest of the epithelial cell types in the epithelial lining, and a basal cell population, little round cells located near the base of the epididymal epithelium. One can see a few slips of smooth muscle starting to form around and start to form a bit of the limiting wall of the epididymal duct. Having made some initial observations, scanning observations, then select a tubule and examine it very briefly at increased magnification for the cytological details. A region of the epididymal epithelium seen at high magnification, showing or demonstrating the principal cells, those tall columnar cells. Their apices are united by tight junctions, as illustrated here, and these tufts or wisps coming off the apical surface are amalgamations of the stereocilia. A basal cell would be as indicated by the tip of the pointer, and perhaps if we move the field slightly, as indicated here, a number of these basal cells can be demonstrated lying upon the basement membrane. These are simply replacement cells for the principal cells. Nonetheless, they are present and satisfy the definition of a pseudostratified columnar epithelium, made up of the two cell types, the principal cells and the basal cells. Close observation, in this particular field, one can make out the tight junctions, or the, as indicated by the tip of the pointer, and one can sort of see the boundaries or the width of the apices of these epithelial cell types. Once again, the stereocilia, and this vacuolated area in the supranuclear cytoplasm is the light microscopic depiction of huge, well-developed Golgi complexes that reside within this particular epithelial cell type. The smooth muscle wall is, if we look at this tubule, is a little bit better demonstrated than this particular tubule. You can see it's only two or three layers thick at this particular point, but it will gradually increase in thickness, in depth, as one approaches the tail of the epididymis, where it's going to join to the next excurrent ductule system, or the excurrent duct system, that is the vas deferens. This is another section of the ductus epididymis, but in this particular case, it's from a man, a human ductus epididymis, and showing you it's roughly the same as in other species, just to demonstrate that particular point. Once again, made up of the two cell types, the principal cell, and even at this low magnification, one can make out the stereocilia coming from the apices of the principal cells, and basal cells also will be present. just a very quick clip to illustrate the lining epithelium of the epididymis from a human subject, showing the basal cells, the nuclei of which are being indicated by the pointer, and the principal cells, which the nuclei, which are much more elongated in nature, from these very tall cells, also now being indicated by the pointer. If one looks at the apices, these are the stereocilia in this human preparation of the epididymis. The ductus epididymis then becomes continuous with the next major portion of the ductal system, the excurrent ductal system, that of the vas deferens, or the ductus deferens, as shown here in the center of the field of view at low magnification, or with the scanning objective. As you will recall, this is the most muscular tube in the body. When examining or looking at the ratio of the lumen to the size of the wall, the lumen, as we will see, it continues to be lined by a pseudostratified columnar type of epithelium, as is the majority of the male reproductive system. An important feature of the excurrent ductal system, or this portion of the excurrent ductal system, is its muscle wall. The wall of the ductus deferens consists of an inner longitudinal layer, as indicated by the pointer and crossed by the pointer, a middle circular layer, which is now being crossed by the pointer, and an outer longitudinal layer of smooth muscle, now being indicated and crossed by the pointer. So this is a very, very muscular tube, which can forcibly expel the spermatozoa in a very short period of time. This is a portion of the wall of the vas deferens as seen at increased or high magnification, illustrating the lining epithelium, which is pseudostratified columnar in nature and consists of, as did the epididymal duct, a lining of principal cells as well as basal cells, those replacement cells for the principal cells. So this particular duct, as is the majority of the male system, is lined by a pseudostratified columnar type of epithelium. It is supported by a thin lamina propria made up of fibroblasts, a few connective tissue fibers, collagen and elastin, and within it will be found typical connective tissue cells and the vasculature, the capillaries. If we continue to course beyond the lamina propria into the muscularis, one can see that the muscle wall consists of inner longitudinal fibers, middle circular fibers, and then finally the third layer, the outer layer of longitudinal fibers. This will all be held in place by a surrounding adventitia. This particular field illustrates a section through the human vas deferens, but one taken through its distal end near the region of the ampulla, that is, near its termination. You can see it's a little bit larger structure, though shows the same characteristics as observed earlier in the primate. One knows immediately that one is dealing with the ampullar region because of this appearance of the elaborately folded nature of the mucosa along its that surrounds the lumen. So this elaborate infolding mimics that of the seminal vesicle. So even though the wall has not thinned out, we are now know we are approaching the distal end, which remains very similar throughout its length when it's not near the ampullar region. It would be very similar to that as was demonstrated with the primate. Nonetheless, it has this robust, extraordinarily thick muscular wall. And if we focus here just a little bit, one can see it has an inner longitudinal, a large middle circular, and outer longitudinal layers. The circular layer in the human being is the most dominant layer of the muscle wall. And I think that can be illustrated here. One can see the broken sort of inner longitudinal layer here, circular, and then outer longitudinal, and then the adventitia here. The primary difference is the mucous membrane, or the mucosa, is thrown into these elaborate folds that mimic the seminal vesicle. This is a section through a portion of the wall of the seminal vesicle, one of the accessory sex glands in the male. This also is human tissue. Like the vas deferens, the seminal vesicle consists of a mucosa, or a mucous membrane, made up of usually a pseudostratified columnar type of epithelium supported by a thin lamina propria. It also has a well-developed muscle wall, a muscularis, consisting of inner circular and outer longitudinal layers. And then there's a connective tissue equivalent to an adventitia that unites the seminal vesicle to adjacent structures. It is characterized once again by the primary, secondary, and maybe even tertiary foldings of the mucous membrane as illustrated here. This is very, very characteristic of the seminal vesicle. Remember, this is a fairly large organ lying at the base of the prostate, and it has numerous chambers, a portion of one of which is shown here, that all unite, that is the lumina of each, unite in a central lumen. If we course now away from the wall of the seminal vesicle, and we're now entering that of the distal vas deferens, so you can see the close proximity. So this is the lumen now, as seen with low power, of the ampulla of the vas deferens. And you can see its thick muscle wall consisting of an inner longitudinal, middle circular, and outer longitudinal layers. You know it's the ampulla of the vas and not a seminal vesicle compartment simply because it's a circular round tubular structure. So this is a tube, the other one is more elongated and flat, and the muscle wall, frankly, isn't nearly as thick. So this is the human seminal vesicle as seen with the scanning objective. This particular field is through the center of the prostate near the prostatic urethra. So we have prostatic glands, or the lumina of some of the glands over in this particular area as seen with this scanning objective. However, the primary element of focus on this particular section are these two oval shaped lumina in the center of the field of view. These two elements are the ejaculatory ducts as they are coursing through the prostate to enter the urethra. A little diverticulum from the urethra is shown here. So this is a little fold that's lined by transitional epithelium. These two ejaculatory ducts will continue on away from us, go out sort of into the field of view, and will eventually join the prostatic urethra. Note that the supporting wall of these two structures has lost its smooth muscle, and it's mainly being supported now at this particular point by a dense band of collagen, or a dense wall of collagen forms the supporting wall. Additional collagenous material is shown in this particular area and is more eosinophilic, or it has a more of a reddish hue than does surrounding smooth muscle, and as indicated here in the fibromuscular stroma of surrounding prostatic tissue. So these are two of the, or the two ejaculatory ducts near the human prostatic urethra. A portion of the wall of the ejaculatory duct as seen at high magnification, illustrating the pseudostratified columnar or stratified columnar nature of the epithelium lining the ejaculatory duct. Its thin, delicate supporting lamina propria, and then the dense collagenous wall giving support to the inner lining mucous membrane. If we course now through to the other side, the other ejaculatory duct, these vents or structures repeat themselves once again. In this particular illustration, perhaps the epithelium looks a bit more stratified columnar in nature, again supported by a thinner lamina propria, and then the absence of smooth muscle, the wall of these particular structures as they course through the interior of the prostate to empty into the prostatic urethra. The ductal system has lost its smooth muscle and now is supported by this dense, irregular type of connective tissue, primarily collagen and fibroblast. Recall that the ejaculatory ducts are formed by the uniting of the distal end of the ampulla of the vas deferens and the duct of the seminal vesicle. Those two elements unite to form a single ejaculatory duct, of which there are two. This particular section is through the prostatic urethra, and the section also transects the prostate, which is shown and outlined by the arrow. So the prostatic urethra is this lumen in the center of this block of tissue, and it of course is going to be lined by transitional epithelium because of its close proximity to the bladder. But this particular scanning views of the entire section shows is the mucosal glands of the prostate, very closely associated and emptying into the lumen right about here. Here are some of these little glands. So these are the mucosal glands of the prostate. Surrounding them to their exterior, another group of smaller glands associated here, and then coursing around as where the arrow indicates, then going out of the field of view. These are the submucosal glands, and these larger glandular structures in the surrounding area and going out of the section in this location are the principal prostatic glands, and it is the principal prostatic glands that are going to make up the bulk of the prostate. And finally, all of these glands and the substance of the prostate are limited by a very vascular fibroelastic capsule way to the exterior, which is not shown on this particular preparation. The section that's in the lone collection is a section very near the capsule and is through the principal prostatic glands. This particular illustration is a low power scanning view through the principal glands of the prostate. A single gland is shown coursing through the center of the field of view. Remember, these are compound tubular alveolar types of glands, and the prostate is a composite gland consisting of maybe 30 to 50 of such glands which have grown out from the prostatic urethra. That is, they grow empty into the urethra. So they've grown out from this area into a surrounding fibromuscular stroma, which will which will develop into a fibromuscular stroma, if one thinks of it in those terms. So this is the gland, a gland, one of the principal prostatic glands. And it was very careful observation one can make out even with the scanning objective. At the tip of the arrow, the abundance of smooth muscle that will contribute to this fibromuscular stroma that envelops and surrounds these glands and their secretory units. So if one courses through and just examines several regions of the prostate, remember these are profiles of different glands coming in from a variety of angles, making it somewhat confusing. But if one remembers the fibromuscular stroma, which is not seen anywhere else in the body that has developed to this extent, and how those whorls course through the substance of the prostate and envelop the prostatic glands. Also characteristic of the prostate are these structures. These are the prostatic concretions, collections of secretory material that accumulate within the lumina of the prostatic glands and seem to increase with age. They may even calcify. So this is the low power view coursing through a region of the prostate that consists or contains mainly the principal prostatic glands. Very, very characteristic. Once again, if we stop midway between some glandular units, note the abundance of smooth muscle, even that can be visualized with this hematoxylin eosin stain, coursing through, wrapping around the glandular units, and forming that intense fibromuscular stroma, characteristic of the prostate. The prostate, once again, principal glands, but seen at a slight increase in magnification. And perhaps one is to able to visualize a little bit more dramatically the fibromuscular stroma. In the center of the field of view is one of the alveoli of the principal prostatic glands, a prostatic concretion located at the tip of the arrow. But now direct one's attention to the surrounding stroma and note the abundance of smooth muscle as it courses around and between the glandular units of the prostatic glands. This is a very good view of this fibromuscular stroma. Very, very dramatic and very characteristic of the prostate. If one just slowly courses at an intermediate power and looks at the prostatic gland coming in this particular left-hand side of the field of view, but keep watching the background with which these glands are embedded in, these 30 to 50 glands, and one will see the fibromuscular stroma coming up quite well, whirling and coursing at a variety of angles. The epithelial lining of the prostatic glands has a more of a mucoid sort of texture to it, or character to it, I should say, like it's producing a mucin type of material, a clear light staining type of epithelium that shows considerable variation depending on the amount of secretory material within it. Some regions showing a pseudostratified columnar, others columnar, and some where it's extremely filled with secretion, may even have a squamous type of character. Here we're going through another region, and here's one of those regions that is perhaps dilated a little bit, having a little more of secretory material within it at one time. Here, coming into the field of view, are two fairly large prostatic concretions, also characteristic of the prostate. You see there are a number of them in this particular field. So these elements, the compound tubular alveolar types of gland of that character, these isolated units appearing within a very dense fibromuscular stroma with the abundance of smooth muscle within the stroma is characteristic and diagnostic for the human prostate. This is a section of normal human prostate stained immunohistochemically for prostatic specific antigen, or PSA. Please do recall that PSA, as well as acid phosphatase, are normally produced by the epithelium of the prostatic glands. So this is simply a demonstration of human prostate using this immunohistochemical marker to show its presence within the epithelium of these principal prostatic glands. And this happens to be a gland we're looking at in the center of the field of view. This edge is perhaps more informative because in addition to the compound tubular alveolar gland of this principal prostatic gland, one again gets to view the smooth muscle in this rather dense fibromuscular stroma and the smooth muscle that courses around the glandular units. This is simply just a demonstration of the prostatic specific antigen as it occurs normally in the prostatic epithelium. This particular section is a cross section fairly high up the shaft of an entire human penis. So this is a cross sectional profile of this particular male reproductive organ. What can be visualized looking at grossly this entire slide is the corpus cavernosum urethri, or the corpus spongiosum, if you prefer to call it using that term, as indicated by the arrow. The penile urethra, or the lumen thereof, lies at the tip of the arrow. Now the other two erectile cylinders also are shown in this particular section. The corpus cavernosum penis, or just the corpus cavernosa, are shown here. The other erectile body is shown here. Note that they are both enveloped by a considerable tunica albiginea, which is shown here. This is all cavernosus tissue occupying the center, or erectile tissue if you prefer to use that particular term. The other corpora is located here, again surrounded by a fairly robust, thick tunica albiginea. The cavernosus tissue, this darker tissue, located at the arrow. So both of the corpora, the corpora cavernosum, are bounded by this very thick tunica albiginea, and near the center, this is where that pectiniform septum is, a septum that usually will have vascular channels going across that allow some communication between these two erectile bodies. The corpus spongiosum, or the corpus cavernosum urethri, also is bounded by a tunica albiginea, but it is much thinner in comparison to those of the other two erectile bodies. This is fairly high up the shaft because ischiocavernosus muscle here, some skeletal muscle is coming into the field. Some other structure that are also shown on this particular structure is a vessel here. This should be the dorsal, a deep dorsal vein of the penis, and just lateral to that should be the dorsal arteries. One there and one at that particular location. So this is a transverse or a cross-sectional profile of the human penis, seen just grossly looking at the entire slide. The only specimen contained within the lone collection is the corpus spongiosum urethrae, which is this structure right here as an example of some erectile tissue, as well as the penile urethra contained within it. One can also visualize quite well the limiting tunica albiginea. This is a field of the dorsal aspect of the penis as seen through the scanning objective. This structure here is the deep dorsal vein. And if we go laterally in either direction, one can see the dorsal arteries of the penis, one of which is shown here, the lumen being located here. These structures usually you see from a gross anatomical perspective, but it would be of interest just to see these structures through the light microscope. And the deep dorsal nerve is in this particular area. You can see the tremendous number of nerve bundles and fascicles in this particular organ, as one would anticipate. So this is the one of the deep dorsal nerves, deep dorsal artery, a central vein, and then if we go on the other side, this system repeats itself. There's the dorsal artery located here, and then once again it's nerve bundles located on scattered around but yet clustered together in the so-called dorsal nerve of the penis. Now if we go down towards its ventral surface, this huge mass of collagen here is the tunica albiginea. It starts here and goes to about this level, and then we get into the cavernosus tissue of one of the corpus cavernosum urethrae, or corpus cavernosa, excuse me. So this is all cavernosus tissue or erectile tissue, and this large vessel, large artery in the center of this erectile tissue is the deep artery. Likewise, if we cut across, this is all tunica albiginea once again. This would be the region of the pectiniform septum between the two corpus cavernosum. Tunica albiginea once again, and then once again into the erectile tissue or cavernosus tissue of the corpus cavernosum. And here again would be that deep artery to these particular structures. And then tunica albiginea, as we are now leaving the two paired corpora on the dorsal surface, and hopefully making our way down finally to this structure here. So this is the urethra, the penile urethra, and you can see there's an abundance of erectile tissue or cavernosus tissue associated with it. It's perhaps not as well developed. And then it also has a tunica albiginea, but note that it is not nearly of the depth of that surrounding the corpus cavernosa, those two dorsal erectile cylinders. You can see this erectile tissue or the cavernosus spaces are suffused with blood yet. And so it repeats itself over and over again, and limited by a much thinner tunica albiginea. So this is the penile urethra. It's mucous membrane surrounded by a lamina propria that goes down the center of the corpus spongiosum, or the cavernosum urethrae, however you want to describe it. This is the epithelium lining the penile urethra, which is fairly high. What is of interest here, these are these mucus secreting glands, these intraepithelial glands, the so-called glands of Latrae, commonly found in the penile urethra. If one looks at the organization, the layering of the epithelial lining of the urethra at this point, several areas are shown that show a stratified columnar type of epithelium, and this is fairly common in this particular area. So this is all stratified columnar, stratified type of epithelium with the surface cells being of a columnar nature. So this is fairly common in the proximal portion of the penile urethra. But even so, because it's this high, there are certain areas, as you get, as we look around, that have a more transitional appearance to them, rather than a stratified squamous type. Again, suggestive of it's fairly high along the shaft of the penis where this particular section was taken. This is a little fold that came out from the lumen, and once again illustrates fairly well these small mucus-secreting groups of cells, the glands of Latrae, that characterize also the penile urethra. Another little cluster, wherever you have these outfoldings, they seem to like to reside in those sort of hidden areas. Those are the glands of Latrae, these little mucus-secreting clusters of cells. Sometimes they do extend a little bit away from the lumen, or so it appears, but they are in that luminal lining epithelium. Here's another little cluster of these mucus-secreting cells. So this is just an example, a fairly well-preserved example of the human penile urethra and its lining epithelium, including the glands of Latrae, which are shown at the arrow. Just a short clip of human seminal plasm illustrating four spermatozoan, or sperm cells. And what these cells show is just the head that's going to contain the nuclear area and, of course, the tails, the details of which really can't be made out in any great form of detail. The sperm in the middle of the field of view does show a little bit, even though it's a little bit disrupted. Right about at this portion is the length or the width of the acrosome as it forms a little cap over the nuclear area. So I believe this little ring right here indicates the end of the acrosome. The remainder of the acrosome fits over the head of the spermatozoan and gives it that short of a shorter, brighter sheen to it. Likewise, one can see the post-acrosomal region right about here at this particular location. So these are simply four sperm or spermatozoa from a human sample from the IV clinic, as seen with the scanning electron microscope. This is a scanning electron micrograph of a human spermatozoan or sperm cell. The nucleus is shown here. The darker area of this head area that contains that nucleus is covered with this darker material, which sort of reflects the acrosome, which goes to about where the tip of the arrow is. The middle piece of this particular spermatozoan extends from this region to here. This is, remember, where the mitochondrial wrap is. And the remainder of the tail that is visible on this particular illustration is the principal piece of the tail. So this is a single human spermatozoan as seen with the scanning electron microscope.